And God called the dry land what? Earth. Earth, earth. Now go to verse 14. God said, let there be lights in the firmament of the heaven, divide the day from the night. Let them be for signs, seasons, for days and years. And let them be for lights in the firmament of the heaven to give light to the earth. And it was so, and God made two great lights. All right, what are these lights? The what? Sun and the moon. Did you just read in your Bible that the earth is older than the sun? Yes, you did. Yes, you did. You just read in your Bible that the earth was here before the sun. Right? You certainly did. Now, that's a big deal. Now, here's what you get into. There's two big words I'm going to throw out here to you, but I just want to give them to you, and I want you to think about it. Geocentric and heliocentric. So what does that mean? It's just a big word. You pay for the education, let folks know you've been in school. Here's what it means. Geocentric means that the earth is the center of the universe. Heliocentric means that the sun is the center of the universe, known universe, our solar system, and everything revolves around the sun. With a geocentric view, the sun and everything revolves around the earth, and the earth is fixed where it is. Now, here's the thing. My little excursion into this has revealed that most of the people that believe in a geocentric view of the earth also believe that the earth is flat. All right, I'm done with him. Am I in a Sunday school class where the preacher believes that we have a flat earth? No, I'm not saying I believe it. But I like debate, don't you? I'm going to throw some things out there for you this morning. I love debate. If what you believe is real, and you really believe it, and you have a foundation for that belief, you should be able to defend it. I have no respect for somebody who says, well, I believe this and that, and you don't have anything to back it up. I'm not saying I believe in a flat earth. No. But there are some interesting points they make. Let me give you one. How many understand if the earth is a ball out here in space, then it has a curvature to it, right? It has a curvature. It's going to have a curvature. You're going to see a curvature. Now, what's going to be more apparent is the higher you get, the more you're going to be able to see the curvature, right? In other words, you have to get to a point in space where you're able to look down on the earth and see the curvature of the earth. And therefore, prove without a doubt, that the earth is round. Now, this gets into the scientific geology or geography or whatever they are, who measure things like this. But did you know that in Lake Michigan, Chicago, Illinois, sits on the western bank of Lake Michigan? How many of y'all know that? Chicago, Illinois, good-sized town. At one time, Chicago was the second largest town in America. Chicago, Illinois. It sits right there. It butts right up again, Lake Michigan. Right up against it, Lake Michigan. You can go 40 miles across the peninsular part of Michigan. I forget the name of the town over there, and it's in another state. And you can get out there on a boat 40-something miles away from Chicago and look across Lake Michigan, and you can see the skyline of Chicago, Illinois. A meteorologist was talking about what he called a phenomenon of a mirage. And he showed a picture of the skyline of Chicago, Illinois. And he said, now this is a classic mirage. I said, what do you mean? And so the meteorologist went into this big, long scientific thing about how, well, now we have these reflecting bands of the earth, and we have this
inversion. We have cold air near the cold lake water and some relatively warmer air above it. This will bend the image of that skyline back towards the viewer. And so typically we would not be able to see this. This image would be viewable from much, much higher in the sky up in space. But instead, we're able to see it on the Lake Michigan shore.
That makes sense, doesn't it? That makes sense for the curvature of the earth. How many are following me here now? See, he was trying to explain to people, how can we 40 miles away see Chicago? And he was explaining to them how that the light was coming up and bouncing back down, and it was a mirage. You weren't really seeing Chicago by looking straight at it. You were seeing a reflection of Chicago through the clouds and the atmosphere and whatever else is up there. So these guys up there, they got in this boat. And you've always got somebody like this. They hooked up their cameras. They had to wait for a certain day to come clear enough, because 40 miles is a long way to see, folks.
The better part of the last year, actually, been really wanting to go up to Lake Michigan to do some tests. And that came as a result of seeing this picture taken by a guy named Joshua Nowicki. And he apparently sent this picture, I guess, to a local news affiliate. And then the weatherman tried to explain what we were seeing by saying this.
What you're seeing here is a mirage. We typically would not be able to see this from the Lake Michigan shore. We talked about this last night.
Okay. Want to sit out? Okay. All right. We're good. Whatever we need.
I think it's amazing, dude. It certainly did. It's not a mirage, I can tell you that.
No.
And they got in their boat, and they hooked up their cameras, and they focused in on Chicago. You could barely see it, barely, because of the haze and the distance. But they kept their cameras trained on Chicago, Illinois, and they began to cross Lake Michigan. And do you know something? Nothing ever changed except Chicago got clearer. Now, if you're following me in all of this, here's the point. If the earth is curved, they should not have been able to see Chicago 40 miles away. Is that right? How many of you know? I don't know. I'm not a scientist. How many of you know how far you have to go before you lose sight of the horizon that you were looking at, say, 10 miles away? See, is that what it is? 12 miles, all right. So how far do you have to go? 12 miles. So you go 15 miles, you're starting to, depends on how tall it is, you're beginning to lose sight of the whatever you saw on the horizon. How many follow me on this now, see? And so by the time you're 25 or 30 or 40 miles away, it should be completely gone because of the curvature of the earth. Well, why did they see Chicago? Now, I'm not saying I believe it, but it makes me think. How did they see Chicago? Airline pilots, when they go up flight level, let's say 30 or 35, in other words, 30,000 or 35,000 feet in the air. Let's say they're up there at 35,000 feet. As they rise in that aircraft, did you know what? Amazing thing happens. The horizon rises. Now, if the horizon was curved, would it rise or would it fall? So you believe in the flat earth? No, but I believe in listening to what they got to say. You see, here's their point. Their point is that God made the earth, and he made everything else as it relates to the earth. And the earth is the center of God's plan for man. And that it is here the issue of sin and salvation is settled. And that because of that, the earth is primary and is of primary importance in God's creation. In plainer words, you're not going to find anything out there that is nearly as important as what you've got going on here. Now, as far as that's concerned, I go with them 100%. Got no problem with that, do you? No, sir. The Bible said the earth is his footstool. No problem with that whatsoever. But here's what they say. They say a sinister element has entered in. What's the sinister element? The sinister element is this. That since the earth is not the center of the universe or the center of the known creation, as we understand it, Therefore, the Earth is really not that important, that it's just a little speck out here in the end, and that what's really important is what's been going on up there, because what's going on up there has been coming down here to visit with us here. There's where your alien introduction comes in. That's where your panspermia comes in. That's where your intervention by these super intelligence comes in, is because the Earth is not really that important. We are not nearly as evolved as they are up there. So what are they doing? They're preparing the world to receive their Savior from up here. You remember the Vatican? You remember Mount Graham out there in Arizona? You remember the Lucifer telescope? The most powerful binocular telescope on Earth? We're not talking about the Hubble. It's not on Earth. It's up there. But we're talking about on this Earth. We're talking about the Apache Indians that said that Mount Graham was sacred and holy to them because it was a doorway, a portal down into the Earth. And the Vatican would not be stopped until they got their observatory right smack in the middle of that on Mount Graham out there in Arizona. And that for decades, reports have come in about people seeing all kinds of strange objects and strange this and that going around and appearing there at Mount Graham. In plainer words, the Vatican has already laid down a systematic way of dealing with aliens when they show up here on Earth. And one of the Vatican spokesmen says, well, it's no problem. If God created us on Earth, he could create anything he wanted to up there. And if they do show up, we'll baptize them into the Catholic Church. That's what he said. I'm serious. I mean, after all, remember their worldview. I'm premillennial. You remember what the Bible says about, the kingdom of heaven suffereth violence and the violent take it by force, right? All right. And so therefore they're building their kingdom on this earth, and therefore they are ruling and reigning over the world and the world of men. And if there's anything else out there, they're going to reign over that too. That's their position. And that's where they're headed. This is why they're having a meeting. When is this meeting coming up now? Here in just a few days, with all these top evangelical leaders and the Pope. And the point of this meeting is ecumenical. And it's to get all these religions together into one. And guess who's going to be over all of them? Of course, the Pope will. The Pope will. No question about that. And that's where they're headed. So, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to read a little more about flat Earth. Here's why.
And what was our focal point?
Our focal point was the Sears Tower.
Which is also known as the Willis Tower, right?
Yes, the Willis Tower.
The Willis Tower, and we can see it the entire time.
We can see it the entire time, and every morning that I fish, I can usually see two of the three. And then when the sun hits the city, you can see three of the three almost every morning, as long as it's clear.
And is it because there's a haze and you finally, like, cutting through the haze?
Cuts through the haze. The sun angle, as soon as it gets high enough, it hits that white building and it just shines.
Gotcha.
But you don't even need to zoom in. I mean, it's right there.
Tony, how long have you been doing this?
I started out when I was 12 and I'm 50 now.
Wow.
Yeah, I got my captain's license in 1985.
Wow.
So we're about halfway across the lake right now, and obviously we can see Chicago, no problem. But we can also see Gary right there. Gary having in Chicago is up around that shoreline if you go around. So we'll have to, when we get back, try to figure out how far the way that is.
Rob's playing Candy Crush.
I'm not playing Candy Crush. that would be my wife. Sheila would be playing Candy Crush, not me. I'm typing, seeing Chicago from 40 miles away, now halfway, it's not a mirage.
Right on. It's not a mirage.
It's not a mirage.
I may never believe the earth is flat, but I may learn a lot of things from it that may help me understand my Bible in ways that I could never understand it before. You say, well, now, preacher, haven't you seen the photographs that they take when they send up these spacecraft and they look down and here's this beautiful globe? They got about 8 or 9 or 10 different globes. And they say, notice how it's changed down through the years. How high do you have to get in the air before you see the curvature of the earth? In other words, if you're not part of the military, or you're not part of the government, or you're not part of NASA, you don't have the capability of going into orbit. You see what I'm saying? In other words, everything you know about space and about what this earth looks like from space, you got it from NASA. Did you know the other day NASA was doing something, I forget what it was up there, and they shut everything down because something popped up there in space and they couldn't explain what it was? Do you see that? When Columbus came across over here and went down into the, where'd he go, in the Indies down in there somewhere, and did you know that Columbus records in his diary, I'm talking about Christopher Columbus records in his diary, he said that when I approached that land, he said the sky was full of vehicles moving and shooting all over the place, and lights were appearing and disappearing, and streaks of color, and this was going here and this was going there. He said it was the wildest phenomenon I've ever seen in my life. Columbus said that long time ago. Do you believe in UFOs? I believe in a spirit world out here, folks. That's nothing but lying and deception. But Satan is a master of deception. He's a master at it. And he's got people's mind now so messed up with so many different things that they can't concentrate anymore on the real issue. And the real issue is your relationship with God. The curvature of the earth. I wish somebody find out for me. You said 12 miles. You said you can't see. I've always heard that if you're on the water, you can see, for example, a battleship 20 miles away. It's higher, see. I remember when the Hood and the Bismarck engaged out there. I think the Hood was 15 miles away from the Bismarck when it started firing its rounds against the Bismarck in World War II. And the Bismarck returned fire, and sad to say, if you didn't know this, the Bismarck struck the Hood, and the Hood was the pride of the British Navy. It was the pride of the British Navy. Magnificent battleship. The Bismarck hit that battleship. It went down with 1,500 young men on it. Went down to the bottom of the Atlantic Ocean. And it was after that that Winston Churchill said, sink the Bismarck. Find it wherever it is and sink it. And they went after the Bismarck and finally found it. And when the first thing they did was disable it, and then it eventually sunk it to the bottom of the ocean. The Bismarck at that time was the greatest, most magnificent battleship on the surface of the seas. But at 15 miles, they opened up against each other, and they were firing these 15, 16-inch cannon against each other. And so it's obvious that they could see something at that distance. So he says 12 miles. I have no reason to dispute that. At 12 miles, you begin to lose the horizon. You begin to lose it. So here's the question. Here's the question. Let's bring you back to square one. If you lose the horizon, let's say at 12 miles, whatever you could see at 10 miles, by 12, it's going under. You can't see it, okay? How could you see Chicago, Illinois, 40 miles away? And I'm not talking about just the tops of the skyscrapers. I'm talking about Chicago right there from the base up. Anybody got any ideas?
There's a guy right there that I do believe is going to finally come out and say it's flat. It's flat.
Now, the meteorologist says that it was a mirage, but it was no mirage the day these guys got in this boat.
Now, this was really interesting, this part right here. We're noticing that the sun, of course, was right above us. It was in the middle of the afternoon. And there was a hot spot just right below the sun, like a localized hot spot. And that didn't really make a whole lot of sense if the sun is shooting parallel light rays across 93 million miles, but I'll deal with that more in the longer version. It's just something that kind of came up as a result of our observations on the lake.
This is 8.5 miles from the actual shoreline.
And sailed across the Lake Michigan and watched it as it went. Anybody got any idea? It's angry. That's aggravating, isn't it?
I don't know, Ken. I mean, I'm seeing it with my own eyes. And all I know is I saw Chicago for 40 miles, and it ain't a mirage.
It's not a mirage.
It's not a mirage. We're going to make t-shirts to say, it's not a mirage.
Set me free, I'm moving around. I wanna go higher. You spin me around and make me see. I wanna go higher. You spin me around. You spin me around. I'm on fire, you spin me around and set me free. I'm moving around, I wanna go higher. You spin me around and make me see. I wanna go higher, you spin me around. You spin me around. Cause I'm on fire, you spin me around and set me free. I'm moving around, I wanna go higher. You spin me around and make me see. I wanna go higher, you spin me around. You spin me around. I'm on fire, you spin me around and set me free. I'm moving around, I wanna go higher. You spin me around and make me see. I wanna go higher, you spin me around. You spin me around. Cause I'm on fire, you spin me around and set me free. I'm moving around, I wanna go higher. You spin me around and make me see. I wanna go higher, you spin me around. You spin me around. I'm on fire, you spin me around and set me free. I'm moving around, I wanna go higher. You spin me around and make me see. I wanna go higher, you spin me around. You spin me around. Cause I'm on fire, you spin me around and set me free. I'm moving around, I wanna go higher. You spin me around and make me see. I wanna go higher, you spin me around. You spin me around. Round. cause I'm on fire. You spin me around and set me free. I'm moving around, I wanna go higher. You spin me around and make me see. I wanna go higher. You spin me around. You spin me around.
Moving around.
And Christ went to the cross and died on that cross to save us from sin. And the blood of the Lord Jesus is the only thing that can wash your sin away. Revelation 1:5. That's all. That's the only thing that can do it.